It's an absolute honour to have you here with us for the National Film Awards. Why are nights like tonight that celebrate the diverse range of talent in our film industry so special and important?
Well, I was invited. It sounded like a great event, and I just happened to be in England for the first time in a long time. And I love film and television. It's a world I've been working in for many years, and I thought it was a great honour to be asked. So that's why I'm here.
See, we're very proud of our homegrown talent here in the UK. Why do you think that, particularly when it comes to acting and technical expertise, Britain seems to be leading the way so often with film and television?
Absolutely, yes. When I'm in America, everyone says, why are there so many Brits up here? No, the Brits are great. There's an enormous amount of talent on a little island.
Talking about your enormous talent, what are you doing next? What's coming up for you in 2018 and beyond?
Well, I've just finished a series called Let's Get Physical. I have four movies coming out, one with Robert De Niro called War with Grandpa, and I'm about to start another movie, a feature, in May.
Excited for all of that. I'm talking about Let's Get Physical first. Can you talk to us a little bit about what fans can expect from that? It sounds like it's going to be quite energetic.
I hope it gets here, but it's a comedy about the old days of the aerobics, about an old gym trying to win back their father's inheritance against sort of a super-duper today kind of gym. And I play the matriarch, the mother of a rather overweight, slothful son who has no intention of doing anything useful in life and has to make the money.
Is there a lot of spandex, I'm assuming?
A lot of spandex, yes. It's a spandex experience.
Obviously, you're working with Robert as well. I mean, De Niro is one of the greatest actors of his generation. Can you talk to us a little bit about that project and what it's been like working with him?
Well, it was a great project to do. There was also Chris Walken, Uma Thurman, and Cheech Marin. It was a comedy and a lot of kids in it. And we had to play, dodgeball, but jumping up and down, trampoline dodgeball. So I not only acted, but I did trampoline dodgeball with De Niro.
Dodgeball is quite a brutal sport. Were there any accidents?
Yes. No, I was amazed. I thought we were going to have a lot of broken hips, but no, we all survived.
I guess my final question on a serious note, I think obviously in the past 12 months there's been a huge discussion about Time's Up and Me Too and how that's changing, particularly our entertainment industry. How do you feel about that movement and how it's progressing?
Well, I don't know what the latest is, but there definitely have been some people who've, needed to be accounted for and have been. And, it's a long discussion, but I think when everyone respects everybody, I think that's going to be a good thing. And it doesn't just happen to women, and it doesn't just happen in show business. It happens in all walks of life, male and female.
Chris, it's brilliant to have you here with us tonight for the National Film Awards. Why are events like this that celebrate our national arts so special and important, do you think?
Well, I think it's great every year to celebrate, the last 12 months and look back over all the great achievements of the amazing films that Britain has produced. So, delighted to be here to enjoy it and to celebrate too.
Are there any particular performers or films that you've got your fingers crossed for tonight?
Well, I think Trainspotting, T2 Trainspotting was massive pressure on them to deliver. The first film was such a huge success, and I think they did an amazing job. So, yeah, that's one I'm hoping gets some recognition tonight.
It's just a conclusion to me of what has been an incredible journey for this film. I'm not a witch. Having won the BAFTA was incredible, so to have this on top and be nominated again, I just couldn't get any better. Again, I'm representing Rangana, who can't be here today. Just really grateful that the film has been so well received and appreciated. Well, I don't think Rangano had any idea that she was making a film that would be so incredibly timely, and yet it has been. No one could have foreseen what this year would have been for women. But this is a film about women having to choose between being a goat or living in a witch camp, which is a choice that a lot of women feel that they are put in. And this is about women just finding the strength to free themselves and realize that those aren't the choices they have to make. They don't have to buy into that system. And I think even though it's a fairy tale from Africa, that's why it's resonated so much. It's so timely and it's so relevant to women all over the world. As I've said before, Rangano could tell the story because she is a woman, and so she had an insight into what it's like to be in that position. And she originally was looking at a lot of different stories, and then when she found the idea of witch camps, that became a beautiful metaphor to talk about questions of challenging the patriarchy, which she's managed to do really successfully in this film and infuse it with humor and pathos and tragedy. So I think it really does take a woman to have those sort of nuances. And I don't think this film would exist without a voice like Rangano's, so very important to empower her. I am writing something that is from Zambia. It'll be about not only looking at how toxic masculinity also affects men as well as women, because I feel that men are actually silent victims of patriarchy. So that'll be the next project that I'm working on. It's not so much just about demonizing them, but for me, seeing how they are also victims of a society that doesn't allow them to be the truest representations of themselves, and also puts a construct essentially on them about being strong, about not having the permission to show their vulnerability. And so I've seen the victims of this in a very personal way. So I think this movement to empower women is actually about empowering men and women to be true to themselves and not have to be constricted by social frameworks that stop them from being who they really are. Because in oppressing either men or women, both suffer.
My name is Mike Beckingham, and I play the lead actor in the film Redwood, which is up for 3 National Film Awards.
It's fantastic to have you with us tonight. What does it mean for you to be nominated at this wonderful celebration of UK film talent?
I think what, as we keep saying, it's really down... What makes it so important is that it's voted for by the public, which is just incredible. For people to actually support you in that way and to take time out of their day and vote for you is amazing.
Obviously, people have voted for this film, but what was it that initially most excited you about the project?
The character of Josh was, he was very complex, he was very layered. We didn't have much time to develop him because with indie filmmaking, it's a wonderful art, but we literally, within 2 weeks, flying out to shoot Poland, and we didn't even do a tabletop read through. So I had to build the character as I went, and that's really exciting. But it's Tom Payton's script writing, which was fantastic. I just really enjoyed the aspect of going and exploring this character, Josh.
You mentioned Tom's writing. What is so special, so unique about his script?
Storytelling. For me, storytelling. Tom is a big, big storyteller, and he loves to be able to make sure the audience comes on that journey with you. That's, I think, what is really important in Tom's writing, is that it's there for you to see.
Looking to the future, have you got other projects that you're working on at the moment?
Yeah, actually, I just flew in from Amsterdam. I'm shooting in Amsterdam as we speak. I've flown in tonight. I fly out back to Amsterdam at 6 a.m. tomorrow morning to shoot a movie called a working title of Amsterdam Secrets. It's along with some quite well-known people that I can't go into quite yet, but you'll be seeing more of it very shortly.
And I guess my final question, we talked about independent cinema. What do you think indie cinema gives both storytellers and audiences they perhaps don't get from other kinds of cinema?
Do you know what? I think it's really important to have both. I think the fact that we have that other cinema makes independent movies so great because they are so different. So it's kind of like one without the other I don't think would work. I think it's important that there's that both those platforms, the big studio film, brilliant films, and then the indie films that get made.
My name's Callan Allen, I'm 17, and I'm from South London.
It's fantastic to have you tonight. What does it mean for you to be part of this celebration of UK film talent?
I'm so excited. It's my first time being here tonight, so I'm so excited to see everyone that's nominated, kind of see everyone's all their hard work that's gone over the past year, so I'm really excited to kind of see that happen. So, yeah, I'm really excited for tonight.
Are there particular categories that you will be keeping your eye on, of course?
Newcomer, best newcomer. I think there's a lot of people that were underrated for a long time that I've kind of seen come up and kind of get their nominations, and they deserve it. So I couldn't pick out of the category, like, who deserves to win, but, the newcomer award, I'm really excited to see who wins that, so yeah.
Looking to the future, what have you got coming up yourself at the moment?
I've got a new movie coming out with Disney in May. I can't really say too much about it, but I produced my own film after that's coming out in September. It's called Clued Up. It has got a girl called Nikita Barron, who's in Disney's A Nutcracker, and a guy called Joel Francis Williams from Casualty. And yeah, it's really exciting. I produced it all myself, and I'm really excited for that to come out, and kind of a lot more exciting stuff. I can't say too much right now, but yeah, super excited.
Obviously, you can't talk too much about that Disney project, but what does it mean for you to work with a studio like that have given us so many iconic stories?
it was crazy. I mean, you know, every kid wants to be, you know, with Disney. Everyone's, you know, dream roles to be with Disney. So I was so excited when I got the call to kind of be a part of it. I didn't think it was real. It was crazy. So yeah, I'm super excited. I mean, I'll be so excited once I can start talking about it a bit more. But yeah, it was super great. So yeah.
Hi guys, it's Fleurice here.
Well, it's amazing to have you here tonight. Why is it important to have nights like tonight where we celebrate the wonderful range of talents we have here in the UK?
I absolutely love film and cinema. This is the first time I've actually been to this event, so I'm so excited. And I'm really excited because there's a lot of British talent and new talent, and Daniel Kaluuya, I'm hoping he wins a couple of awards. Not just one, a few awards.
Why is he someone that you are so passionately rooting for tonight?
Because I saw him initially in Black Mirror, and I was like, oh my gosh, he's British, no way. Then I saw him again in Get Out, and I absolutely loved Get Out. And then I just thought, oh, he's flying the flag. He's flying the flag for the UK, so I'm really excited.
When you're not celebrating here tonight, what have you got coming up the rest of the year and beyond?
Well, more music this year. And I'm actually branching out into the fitness world. So I've got a product called The Weight Gym that's coming out this summer. And I designed it with my cousins. And I can't wait for people to have that in their homes and get on their journey to keep fit.
Now, as someone who needs to get fit, what can you tell us about that product, what that is, and how it's going to change my life?
Well, it's a little unit. It's basically called a gym in a box. And it's got everything that you can do in the gym, but in a little toolbox. And you can carry it around with you. It's 14.5 kg. And literally you can pull it out from under your bed, in your living room, wherever you are, take it on holiday, and you can do a full body workout with it. So it's pretty amazing.
Sold. And obviously we're very excited that there's going to be more music this year. Can you tell us just in general what fans can expect from that?
Yes. It's still going to be feel good, really energetic, uplifting, but a lot more modern sounding, a little less throwback. So I'm excited. I can't wait.
Why is that an important change for you to move away from that kind of classic sound that you're, I think, maybe best known for?
Yeah, it just naturally happens, natural progression, you know. You get inspired by so many things around you all the time, and I just felt like I've grown so much since I did the show, so yeah.
Looking back, I mean, obviously the show has catapulted you to very exciting things. What is your most special, your most fond memory of that whole journey now?
I think coming back to the X Factor to perform as an artist for the first time, I actually cried in rehearsals because it was just so surreal. I was like, I've been working all these years to get to this stage, and that was the moment that it actually turned a corner for me. So, yeah, amazing.
Are you still very much supported by Simon and the rest of the team?
Yeah, there's still a lot of love. No love lost. You know, I'm not really with Psycho anymore, but there's, you know, no beef. It's all good. You know, just creatively these things happen. You just go in different directions. But yeah, they still support me. And yeah, they're a lovely team.
See, at the moment, we're seeing so many exciting young British acts coming through. Is there anyone you would love to collaborate with, given the chance?
There's a long list. The list is too long. I'd love to do something with Craig David. I'd love to work with Stormzy. There's a few people, yeah.
I mean, Craig's obviously had a huge resurgence. Do you think it's nice in a way that he's finally been given the credit as the recording artist that perhaps he wasn't during his initial sort of heyday?
Definitely. I think because his first album was literally one of my favourite albums ever. And he's such a lovely person and he works so hard. And I think that's a testament to him, to his character, that he's been able to come back and just blow up in such a big way.
And my final question, have you got a message to all the fans out there who can't wait for the new music and to get fit as well?
Yes! Guys, it's coming. Get ready to get fit. Get ready to start dancing again. Because I'm back, people.
Woo! Hi, I'm Larissa Eddy, TV judge, singer-songwriter.
All-round superstar. Larissa, it's amazing to have you with us tonight. What makes nights like tonight, where we celebrate UK talent, so special and important?
I think it's brilliant to always celebrate UK talent in music and film and any of the creative arts. I think it's just, you know, the English are kind of doing so well at the moment, you know, especially in music, people like Adele and Ed Sheeran, and also in film, so many up-and-coming breakthrough actors. So, yeah, it's a really exciting time.
Why do you think, particularly when it comes to music, so often Britain has led the way culturally and in terms of new trends and new style?
I think the UK have always been kind of renowned for breakthrough music acts, you know, even the Beatles and people like that. So, yeah, I just think it's kind of in our English blood. Well, I've just recently been a TV judge on All Together Now, the BBC One show. So I had an amazing time filming that alongside Jerry Halliwell and Rob Beckett. So yeah, it was just great to kind of get involved in my first TV show, really. And I've got my new single out called Where I Belong on YouTube now, so check it out.
If people haven't checked out that single yet, what can they expect from the new track?
It's got a country feel, but it's still very pop rock. But yeah, it's a real feel-good track. We recorded it in Brighton on the beach, so yeah, check it out.
John, it's amazing to have you here with us for the National Film Award. Why are nights like tonight, where we celebrate the range of amazing talent we have in the UK film industry, so special?
Tonight, in particular for me, is that this is voted for by the public. And not all awards are. You know, we have academies, we have, you know, you have all the different voting panels and stuff like that. I just love that this is voted for by the public. I think it's kind of really cool. And so that's why I'm here tonight. I kind of, it's nice, yes. It's humbling, if I'm honest. You know, it's, I like the academy thing and I like it when your peers recognise your work and stuff like that. But for the public to sort of nominate you, it means a lot to me, yeah.
Of course, we've been loving seeing you on our screens at the moment. The show's been a huge hit. Can you talk a little bit about how it feels to be part of an adaptation of such an iconic story?
Yeah, it's, I mean, I love it. You know, like on a very simple level, it's kind of why I came into this business. You know, you could argue it's why we act. You know, it's swords and sandals, it's boys and toys, it's epic, it's... I love it. I love the archetypes and stuff. I think we've spoken before about... As a writer, I'm really interested in the archetypes and you know, so to be playing Agamemnon, one of the great archetypal characters, I kind of, it's not lost on me, you know, it's beautiful. And the public response, I love it. I love being part of a big show, you know, it goes out on Netflix next week and Saturday night, BBC. That's not lost on me, that stuff. You know, I grew up watching those shows and to be in one of them, it's kind of fun, you know, it's like, ultimately it's fun, you know, it's an honour, it's a privilege. I've got great friends of mine, great actors, some of the best actors I've ever worked with in the fringe theatres, and they've never been paid to work and stuff, so it's not lost on me to go and do a big show like that and get treated well and tell a great story. Yeah, storytelling. You know?
I think it seems to be such a golden age for television at the moment. Why do you think that, particularly with miniseries and this kind of very high production value series, we're seeing that rediscovery of television as a storytelling medium?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's a cliche, but you know, the time that you get to tell a story in itself, like, you know, that's going to attract people. You know, it's good and bad. It's like with everything. You know, we've got 90 television channels now, countless movies coming out every week. And so the downside to that is you're going to get mediocrity. You're going to get things that aren't quite cutting the mustard. But then the upside of it is everyone gets a go. And hopefully, you know, you're going to get lots of talent coming through and, as a result, you're going to get some exciting work. You know, you're going to get new names coming through. You know, you're not going to get the same stale old faces like me. you're going to get young people coming through. You're going to get exciting voices that maybe we've not heard before. So it's a good time, man. It's exciting. I'm loving this generation at the moment. I think it's good. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about, you know, obviously, as you say, kind of goodbye to this film in a way, what it means for you that the film has been so consistently celebrated and recognised over the past year?
Thanks, man. I don't know, really, you know. All I did was I wrote something from the heart. I wrote something that meant a lot to me. I got, we got a group of people together that got it and understood it. And we made the film we wanted to make, you know. We didn't really make it for anyone or, you know, we made the film we wanted to make. And so I think if you do that and you have your own truth within it, I don't know. It's not lost on me that the public... We didn't get cinema screens with this film. That's the truth of it, you know. We got the most astonishing reviews. But even with those reviews, we never got many cinema screens. And normally that would mean your film is dead in the water. And so it's the public that got behind this film. And the press originally, but the public, they just got behind it. And it just kept growing. And then all the nominations came and nights like tonight. I mean, in answer to your original question, that's why these nights are important. A film like Jawbone would have disappeared once the cinemas decided it never had an audience. It would have disappeared. But the public, thankfully, have said, no, it has got an audience. We're it and we want to watch it. And also Netflix. Once Netflix bought the film, people started to watch it and the word of mouth grew. And I'm really grateful, you know, like to everyone. Thanks for supporting it, you know, and watching it and enjoying it. Yeah.
Yeah, I think we get a lot of attention from the American film industry, and they get a lot of attention, as they rightly should, because they're amazing. But it's great to have a night where you're actually celebrating British filmmakers and emphasising really British expertise in this field. So yeah, this is a great night to celebrate British film internationally. I heard the other day that the Monty Python team were brought over to Germany in the early 70s to do a show there, and you think, how could that translate? Somehow, British humour, even in countries where you think that humour doesn't translate, it translates. And so I think British humour is universal. I think we seem to have a knack for idiocy, and I think that knack is selling around the world, so we should just keep doing more of that.
In terms of the future, what have you got coming up yourself at the moment?
In the next couple of weeks, you'll see Timeless on E4 here in the UK, obviously on NBC. We're on episode 4 by now. It's a time travel adventure series, second season, and it's great fun.
What can fans expect from the rest of the series?
For the rest of the series of Timeless, I can't reveal anything. You haven't even seen the first episode of season 2 yet. But you can expect everybody to go through the mill. And the one thing I will tell you, as I'm sure you might have seen online, is that all the main characters live together in a bunker. It's pretty cozy.
What's it like working with the rest of the cast? Because it seems like a wonderful team you've got with you on that project.
Yeah, I feel like the cast have really gelled this season. Being in Los Angeles means that a lot of people are home, so it's all a lot more relaxed and less travel and fraught. So, yeah, we all get on really well. We're absolute fools, really. We jump around and fool around on set, and then we do our work, but it's very, very much fun.
Who's the biggest fool?
I'd say that I was.
Why are nights like tonight that celebrate our UK film talent so special and important, do you think?
Well, you know, the UK film industry is becoming one of the strongest in the world now. You know, we're producing such great artists, such great movies. And especially the independent films as well, they're doing so well. And I just think it's great for the British market. You know, it's great that celebrating it and having all these wonderful people here. I'm really excited to be a part of it tonight. I'm hosting an award for the best British actor, so that should be great.
Obviously, we've loved having you on our small screens lately, but that is drawing to an end. How do you feel about that at this point?
Yeah, I mean, Hollyoaks has been such a great experience for me. I've really enjoyed doing it. It's been 2 years. My character's gone through so much stuff in such a short space of time. I mean, I started off as a straight, married policeman. Now I'm a closeted homosexual and no longer a policeman. So, you know, my character's gone through so much change, and he's now a murderer. So, yeah, it's mad. But that's Hollyoaks, I guess.
And obviously, Hollyoaks is a lot of fun, but how important do you think it is that our mainstream drama tackles particularly LGBT issues in a way that's accessible and obviously helps with that dialogue?
Well, Hollyoaks is probably one of the most LGBT-friendly shows out there. We have such a diverse cast. We even have transgendered actor in our cast. And it's just great that we tackle such strong storylines about the LGBT community. And I think that Hollyoaks is probably one of the only soaps that really does that and puts the issues that are actually out there in today and on the television screen and make them real. And that's what they are. So it's great. It's really great to be part of it. And I think we are probably one of the most gay-friendly soaps with actors and cast members in it as well. So, yeah.
See, we are also very excited about the tour. Can you talk about what it's going to be like, particularly with the Steps gang going out and playing some pretty big venues?
Yeah. Summer of Steps, Blue, Aqua, Steps, Sara Alto. It's a great lineup, and it's going to be really good fun across the whole of the UK, doing great big stadium capacity gigs. And yeah, it's going to be really good fun, and I love getting on the road with the boys. You know, we've been doing it for 18 years now, and just to get on the stage with them, sing all the classics and have all the audience singing back, it's the best feeling in the world. You know, you can't beat a better buzz than that. And yeah, it's going to be fun, and we love playing to big venues like that. So I think they're kind of 25,000 minimum each venue, so it's playing to a good crowd.
Final question. Obviously, when you do play those venues, fans are singing along, and these songs mean a lot to them. Yeah. Is there one track in particular that means the most to you when you get to do it with the boys almost 2 decades later?
Hey, babes, you all right? Do you know what? I just love singing all this song. I think the one that connects the most with Oh. I think the one that connects the most with the audience is probably One Love. Because, you know, One Love is all we need, isn't it, really?
Well, it's nice. It's good to celebrate things, especially at this point in time.
Curious, as a storyteller, what matters more to you? Awards recognition, audience response, how you feel about the work? What's the most important thing when you wrap a project?
I don't think I've ever experienced the dizzying heights of feeling smug about a show, but I've come pretty close with this because I just felt like we had all done what we'd set out to do. And as my friend Melanie Jessup pointed out, we achieved this thing of having this sort of whodunit puzzle of the week, and at the same time this ongoing mystery between just two people, and that just seemed like a killer combination. But it's very important to me that people like it, and that's why awards like this are important. Yeah. Well, a holiday is just a joy, and there's incredible focus, but a lot of laughter. Quite often spontaneously breaks into laughter in the middle of a scene, which tends to make me start laughing. And then when I say, what are you laughing at after the take, she says, I don't know. So that's always nice.
What have you got coming up the rest of the year and beyond?
No, not in the immediate future, no. Hopefully more of these.
Obviously, I mean, we've seen you a lot on our small screens. I'm curious how that experience compares to working on feature.
I'm a bit of a baby when it comes to features. A feature, perhaps. I don't think I've had that much experience.
Why do you think we've seen that resurgence of television in the miniseries in particular?
I think, you know, in this country, it started with Our Friends in the North and shows like that. It was TV that took it into a novelistic place because it realised it could, because it had the time to. It's just about having the bravery to hold back and let things evolve their own way.
Some of the series you've been involved with have had a huge fan base. When fans meet you, what are the most common questions they fire at you at events like this when they get to rub shoulders with you?
I don't think there's any one average sort of question I've had from fans. Quite broad.
Do you have a message for all those fans who voted for you at this awards and continue to support you with all the great things you've got coming up?
Immense gratitude, and I hope we continue to do you proud in the future.
Obviously, film is always going to be really important, and it's just, you know, it changes so much over the years. And when you have anything dedicated actually to film, it's always important to come. And I've actually come to honour my old drama teacher, who is an amazing woman, and she's going to get the Lifetime Achievement Award tonight. So I feel like everything's so fast-paced now as well, and all these young kids can make films on their own, and everybody's doing everything digitally and by themselves, and I feel like we don't want to lose the actual, you know, the filmmaking, and we don't want to lose the like you say, you know, the education of actually what goes into making film.
For the industry, it's a very important time in terms of the discussion about how women are treated, both in front and behind the camera. How overdue do you think that conversation is, and how optimistic are you about the progress that's being made currently?
I feel like I'm really optimistic. I live in Los Angeles. It's a huge deal there right now. I actually have my own foundation that supports women, and I have networking events, so I can see firsthand, like on a monthly basis, how women have been affected and have been treated. And I feel like you don't want this to become like a man-hating thing as well. So I think that there has to be a balance, but it is way overdue. And I've spoken to so many men that say that it's just been a thing that even in workplaces, a lot of the time, a lot of them feel like they are guilty, and it might not even be sexual harassment, but it's just that they have felt in some way superior, or they've been paid more, and that's just been allowed to happen. So it's just something that needs to change, and I feel like it's deeply ingrained in some generational kind of weird, like, I don't know what it is, but it's kind of something that's just been like a natural process, and it's been allowed to happen. And I just feel like now women have woken up to it and just don't really want to stand for it anymore. But I don't feel like it's an attack specifically against every man. I feel that has to be kind of a balance as well, really.
Of course, Frances McDormand at the Oscars was calling for the use of inclusion riders. Do you think that's the kind of concrete step that people including stuff like that in their contracts that might make a difference, might change the industry?
Yeah, I feel like they're doing so much. They're doing probably the same here as they are in Los Angeles. And I feel like the women are doing so much, the men are doing so much as well. Nobody wants to be seen as like somebody that may feel that like they're guilty of something that they haven't done. But there's a huge movement right now and I'm just all for it. I think it's amazing.
I am such a movie buff, so it'll be interesting to see everybody's credentials and who wins what. And it's just a lovely evening out and it's a bit classier than a lot of other ones I've been to for a change, hence the outfit. There's been so many films out lately that I've really, really enjoyed. There's too many. I honestly, I still go back to the old school. I still love the John Hughes films. You know, Ferris Bueller, Pretty in Pink, you know, all that stuff. I love the old stuff. You know, my very first film was The Goonies on VCR. Do you remember that?
Goonies Never Say Die?
Oh, that's our saying. Goonies Never Say Die.
Goonies Never Say Die.
So this is my manager, Bill.
Hi, Bill.
We have a bit of a meme off sometimes, and the truffle shuffle, and the pictures of, is it the pictures of hell?
Yeah. I need to know this. Have you done the truffle shuffle then? Are you a truffle shuffle?
You sent me the truffle shuffle the other day, and I said, I just want that chicken, and the balloon, and the egg to pop. I mean, come on. It's brilliant. Hello. It's us, Steph! It's brilliant. I literally had a Goonies off with one of my friends. I could literally annoy the hell out of anyone and say everything before they do.
My final question, when you're not annoying people with the Goonies, what have you got coming up yourself in 2018 and beyond? What have you got at the moment?
Well, there's a lot. There's quite a few things in the pipeline. Not a lot of which I can talk about just right now. What can I talk about?
Nothing at the moment.
There you go.
There's lots in the pipeline.
Yeah, the Fratellis. No, I'm joking.
Let's move on.
Guys, it's absolutely amazing to have you here with us for the National Film Awards. Why nights like tonight where we celebrate our national talent so very special and important, you think?
I think because there is so much of it. It needs to be celebrated. And James was saying earlier, it's nice for us to come here, and it's a very different industry to the one that we work in. So it's kind of a night off for us. So it's nice to come and appreciate it as, like genuine film fans.
We have such like a wide genre of film we like, so I wouldn't want to say one in particular because we're presenting an award as well, so we can't really give away our allegiances. But there's a lot of good films coming out at the moment.
Of course, you guys have new music coming out as well later in the year. You talk a little bit about what fans can expect overall from the new album?
Good vibes. It's a two-part album, so this is the second half. So hopefully something quite upbeat that people can also get emotionally invested in. That's kind of the goal.
Can you talk about what fans can expect from the tour if they're lucky enough to get a ticket?
Yeah, it's the night and day tour. We're super excited. It's going to be like the best tour we personally think we've ever done. Full UK tour, full Europe tour. And there's some great support acts and we're super excited, man.
It's a lot of fun. It's obviously you've got to have fun in moderation. That's the best kind of fun because if you have too much, you can't perform the next day. But usually, yeah, we've got certain cities that we'll go out in and have a good time in.
See, on tour, often things do go wrong and weird stuff happens. Have you had any near misses or disasters on the road before?
Me and Con have nearly... Well, we have missed flights, me and Con, from being a bit worse for wear the morning after a night out. So that's probably the worst case scenario, is missing a flight, to be honest.
You guys have some of the most devoted and supportive fans. Have you got a message for them about what that support means for you guys, particularly when you get a chance to meet them on tour?
It's the seventh year of the Vamps this year, sort of. So to be able to have 7 years in this industry is a credit to them. So thank you for making us have a great time.
Obviously, like you say, 7 years now, you guys have been with us for quite some time. Do you ever see a future without the Vamps, or is it always going to be something that you're part of?
We really enjoy it. Yeah, me. The broth is next level. I think the Vamps to us is more than just like a job. So I would love to do it forever. I'm sure we'd all like to do it. We enjoy it.
Obviously, we've seen some great films made about bands and stuff like that. Are we ever going to get a Vamps movie?
Oh,
Maybe, yeah, maybe at some point. We did a book a couple of years ago, which was pretty fun, so film seems like the next progression, so fingers crossed.
You play yourselves, or would you want other people to be playing it?
We'd probably get Elijah Wood to play Con, Leonardo DiCaprio for Triss. Who would play you? Bear Grylls. Johnny Depp. That's who we'd get, I think. We love you. Thank you for your continued support. We can't wait for you guys to hear the next batch of music we're about to release. We'll see you on the road. Mwah.